Dolly Parton has new double Ds. Double discs. A CD and a DVD from her concert in London. What did you think I was talking about?
Here you come again. Just when I've begun to get myself together, you walk right in the door, just like you've done before, and you wrap my heart round your little finger. Here you come again.
Her new CD, DVD just out this week is called Dolly Live from London. You'll see her sing her biggest hits, 9 to 5, Jolene, Cone of Many, Coat of Many Colors, plus new ones from her latest album, Backwoods Barbie. So, Dolly, here you come again. You're messing my mind. You're filling up my senses. She's joining us live right now. Dolly, it is a pleasure to see you again.
Well, it's good to see you. I love your double D's line. Yeah.
I wrote that up specially for you.
That's what you meant. You got the DVD and a CD, one on each side. So that's perfect. I'm going to use that from now on. But we're very excited and proud of the Live from London concert that we did last year and put together. And now we have this wonderful CD, DVD out, and we're out talking about it because it makes a good Christmas present.
Well, here, Dolly, anything you do is a good Christmas present, let's face it. I should start with this. I was watching the DVD and listening to the CD. I, of course, love the songs. My favorite part was actually hearing you talk to the audience because so many artists today don't take the time to do it. They're so busy changing their costumes and changing the set for the next song that you never really get to hear the personal side of the stories. And I love the story that you tell about your dad and the statue. And I was wondering if you could retell it for us today.
Well, that's actually a very personal story. My dad was, as I mentioned in the DVD, my dad was a very quiet and shy person, but he kind of had a way of kind of putting things in perspective. And I remember when they put a bronze statue of me in the courthouse yard in my hometown, I was just going on and on and on. I was so proud of it, even to the point to where I guess I was sounding a little too proud. And my dad, I said, Daddy, ain't that the greatest thing in the world? He said, yeah, I think that is a great thing. He said, and I know that to your fans out there, you may be some sort of an idol, but to the pigeons, you're just another outhouse. So, and then, of course, my dad has passed away now, but after my dad passed away, they told me Daddy used to take a bucket of soapy water at night. He'd load up his little pickup truck and go down and scrub the pigeon dew off of my statue. And I thought that was the sweetest story, and I just cried when I heard it because that's just like something a daddy would do, especially mine.
I love hearing that story. I love hearing about your mom and your dad. Of course, you're one of 12 kids. You grew up in East Tennessee in Sevierville County. That's where you went to high school. Your dad was a farmer and was illiterate. And that was part of the reason you say that you started your charity for kids to get them to read books. I'm curious how often you think about growing up like that. I mean, a lot of people dream about being rich and famous like you do. I wonder if you ever dream about being being poor and growing up like that.
Well, I think about it all the time. Never a day goes by that I don't think of my home and my family and my mama and daddy. And my dad was one of the smartest people I've ever known in my life. He, like so many other people in that part of the country, didn't get a chance to get an education because they were from big families. They had to go to work to, you know, put food on the table. But yes, I think about it. I still write those songs and I sing the songs even to myself about home and try to always keep that anchor. And that's, I think, one of the things that has kept me sane in this crazy world where some people do get all messed up over it.
As I was watching the DVD, I was wondering what your favorite song is to sing live and which song that after a while you just think, I wish I could drop this from the set list.
Usually when I get to singing one that I get a little tired of, I will drop it out of the set list for a little while. But I know that the fans want to hear them all because that's what they want to hear. And it doesn't matter what I think, although I can honestly say I enjoy it because it's, they're good songs, hopefully. And so there are songs like Coat of Many Colors that's always near and dear to me. I always love that. I Will Always Love You is always a great song for a singer because you got all that range and you can sing it as big or as little or as loud as you want to. But I enjoy them all. And my songs, as I've often said, are like my children, and I expect them to support me when I'm old.
I wonder, over the years, since so many artists have covered you, and you mentioned Whitney Houston, of course, doing I Will Always Love You. In the DVD, you also talk about Norah Jones covering your song The Grass Is Blue, which I had never heard before and thought was a beautiful rendition. Is there a specific cover that someone has done for you over the years that really touched your heart?
Well, it touches my heart when anybody records one of my songs, and I'm one of those songwriters. To a songwriter, you just love the fact that somebody else wants to do your songs, and you also realize that everybody has their own interpretation of that song, and you also see how many different ways a song can be arranged. So I'm proud of all of it, but I have to say that what Whitney Houston did to I Will Always Love You, it would be really hard to top that one.
I love the way that you say it in the concert in front of the London audience, where you say to them, I Will Always Love You. Hey, that's a great name for a song. I think I'll give it to Whitney. I love that line.
Yeah.
I love that line. Now, I have to say, the last time you were here at CNN, I don't know if you remember when you came down to Atlanta, but we had the chance to have, I had probably the best Dolly moment that I could ever dream of, which was we got to sing Islands in the Stream together. And I only bring that up because when you were here, and it reminded me of what one of your tour people says in the backstage part of the DVD, which is that whether you're in front of 10,000 people or in front of 10 people, you always do it up big. You always give them the Dolly experience that they have come to expect.
Well, that's a sweet and wonderful thing to say, because I love the fans and I love people, and I do feel like I'm at home, whether I'm with a big crowd or whether I'm with just a few people. I think I get that from my upbringing. We're very friendly people, my mom's people and my dad's people, so I came by that. That's just how country people are.
Dolly, I got a chance to go to Dollywood a couple of months ago, which was fantastic, by the way. You have,
thank you.
I loved it. I love the museum that you have, Chasing Rainbows. And you also have your tour bus outside, which people can now tour. And I went inside. It was really cool to see how it was all set up in there. And actually, we're showing right now a picture that I took inside of your bedroom in there. And I also, which was really fun to see, but I noticed that there are mirrors on the ceiling as well. What is that about, Dolly?
Well, that's just to make the room feel more open, because when you live in small spaces, you put as many mirrors as you can to make it feel like that you're living in a more open space. It's more like an open sky.
Got it.
But if I was kinky, I might could make use of it.
Speaking of that, I noticed that recently on your Twitter account, you tweeted something very interesting. You said, "Ah, chiropractor, hurts so good. You lug these things around and see if your back don't hurt."
Well, people are always, they're always writing stuff in the tabloids about how I'm down in my back, can't get up because my boobs are so big I can't carry them around, and and this and that. So when I actually had to cancel a couple of tours last year because I had actually pulled my lower back, had nothing to do with these, and I had made that comment and everybody got a kick out of it, so I threw it in again.
What do you think about these young up-and-comers like Miley Cyrus? She apparently is planning a birthday party for herself that's going to have a Dolly theme where everyone has to dress up as Dolly Parton. Kelly Pickler recently appeared on Ellen. She dressed up as you. What do you think when these young girls are coming up and they are emulating you?
Well, I think they're all just having fun with that particular part, because I'm fun to, it's easy to kind of look like me. All you need is like get your big old padded bra and a big old cheap wig and put you on some extra makeup. You got that part down. But when they sincerely say that I have influenced them or meant something to them, or they've patterned certain things after me, that is one of the greatest compliments that you could ever pay any artist. Because you never know when you're starting out what you're going to mean to people, or if you're going to leave anything worthwhile behind. So now that I'm older and can, when I see and hear that, when all these people that I admire, like Taylor and all the ones that you mentioned, when they say something about me, it's like, wow, that's great. So it feels good.
Well, Dolly, I wish you luck with this CD. Again, it's called Live from London. It comes out this week. It's, as we say, a double D, a CD and a DVD. And I have to say, meeting you in person when you came down here to Atlanta was definitely the best interview experience I've ever had, and I've talked about it ever since. So it was a real pleasure.
Okay, you want to sing Islands in the Stream?
That is what we are.
No one in between.
How can we be wrong? Sail away with me.
That little slight delay in our satellite
feed
is bizarre.
It is.
Anyway, I love you, thank you, and I like singing with you. We'll do a duet one day for real.
All right, Dolly, I'm holding you to it.
Thanks. Okay.